welcome once again to EWTN's Bookmark. I'm Doug Keck, your host. Our special guest is author Michael O'Neill. They Might Be Saints on the Path to Sainthood in America is the title, proudly published by us here at EWTN Publishing. Welcome, Michael. Great to see you on Bookmark.
It's great to be here. Thank you, Doug.
Now, a lot of our audience would know you from the Miracle Hunter radio show, as well as other programs you've done for EWTN over the years.
That's right. It's a great thing to be able to connect this book to my show, They Might Be Saints, which airs each week on EWTN. So I think it's a kind of a fun thing to tell more about the lives of the saints that people could see on the program itself.
Absolutely. And a lot of your focus has been on saints in the United States and people who either were working in the United States or even born in the United States, right?
That's right. I tried to come up with a formula or a way to figure out the number of people. We came up with 24 Venerables and Blesseds, and those people who are either born in the United States or who lived the majority or over 50% of their life in the United States. So that's how we kind of cut off which people belonged and which people were out in the book.
What's nice in this book, too, I like, is that you kind of give an overview of the process, which I think in a lot of cases was new to you as you explored doing this, and then kind of break down different ones at different stages so people get a really positive overview of the whole process and also who's in the pipeline, so to speak.
That's right. I think that, I've learned a lot about the sainthood process doing the show They Might Be Saints, because every episode we kind of show where that candidate is along the process. So I have to learn those various stages: servant of God, venerable, blessed, and saint. And, a lot of people don't really know about how it all works, and they assume that it went back to the earliest days of Christianity. But this process, as we see it right now, has only been around for a few hundred years. And we kind of have the idea that maybe somebody whispers in the ear of the Pope, or he reads something and he decides, let's canonize somebody. But it takes years or decades or even centuries for somebody to raise up to the level of saint. So it's a fascinating process.
Now, at the beginning of the book, you talk about an experience, you say, related to the Miracle Hunter, about investigating claims of the supernatural, that you came to EWTN, had a discussion with some people here, some of whom I know personally, about this concept, and you kind of said, I got a warm reception, but not a full commitment to the network, to the project. And you say you went back and you kind of ruminated on who the real miracle hunters in America really are, and you came up with the idea of the vice postulators.
That's right. So there are some miraculous events that have happened in United States history. We could talk about Our Lady of La Leche. She was recently crowned there in Florida. Or you could talk about the Chapel Chimayo in New Mexico, this Lords of the Southwest, or Our Lady of Prompt Succor in New Orleans. But really, when you compare us to Europe, we have very few sort of miraculous stories. But the places where we do have big stories of miracles relate to canonization causes, because for every saint, you need a miracle to be named blessed and then a subsequent miracle to be named saint. So the real people who are hunting for miracles out there are those vice postulators who take all that input and submit it to Rome.
Right. And I know one of the things for EWTN when dealing with miracles is we always have to make sure that there's some substantial church support for anything going on, because there's wonderful stories and we hear them about various people who've been on the network, but as much as we'd like to publicize them, we have to be in a position of making sure what the church's opinion is and not just our opinion on a particular miracle or proposed miracle.
That's right. And I think that miracles, the approval process is clear as mud. And I think I've run into a lot of people who assume things are approved and they really aren't. It has to go through a very formal investigative process. You look at Marian apparitions specifically, they really go through this very serious process, approving the devotion, but then really approving the supernatural character of the event. Right. So until that happens, we can't really consider anything fully approved in the church. And there are very, very few cases like that in the United States.
Right. As you kind of alluded, you said, well, it is commonly thought that the Vatican seeks out all the cases of miracles and investigates each potential legitimate one. The reality is that other than maybe at Lourdes, and you explain why you say other than Lourdes, healing miracles are investigated and officially approved by the Catholic Church, are investigated and officially approved by the Catholics only when they're related to canonization saints, right? That's the whole issue. And I think you write in the book as well, it's not like they have an army of people over there scouring the world looking for miracles, right?
That's right. I mean, I think if they had a miracle hunter team, I hope I could apply to that team and they'd send me different places. But
we're doing
it doesn't
our
work
best.
That way at
we're
all.
Doing
only
our best.
In canonization causes do they actually investigate miracles.
Right. And that's how They Might Be Saints came up, the idea of telling stories of people who we can't get out in front of the church, but have powerful, powerful, faith-filled stories.
Exactly. And I think it combines two very attractive things in our faith, which are the lives of saints. Everybody loves a good saint story, and especially saints from the United States. It's kind of a remarkable and inspiring thing to think that there were people who walked here on American soil who are on their way to heaven or being declared that they'll be in heaven. And then everybody loves a good miracle story. And these are the cases that are fully validated by Rome and the ones that are in process to being validated. So I think that there's a lot of excitement when you pair those two things together.
Right. And one of the things you point out, you say, I found that there was almost universal interest in the projects from the various guilds and organizations supporting the future saint. Because a lot of us, like you were indicating, would think, well, the church decides to look into it. But it really is a local grassroots effort to begin the process, right?
Absolutely. I think that sometimes it begins with friends or families, or in the case of a priest or a nun from their communities, those are the groups of people who have the greatest interest in having their person be recognized by Rome in a formal way. And that all starts on the local level. So you have these people who are promoters of the cause, vice postulators who are gathering all the data. And miracles often happen in the diocese where that person lived, because that's why people knew that they existed in the first place. Because one of the interesting things that I think is worth talking about is that the church requires cases of singular intercession when it comes to miracles. Mm-hmm. So you couldn't go to Rome or to the vice postulator and say, well, I prayed to Padre Pio and John Paul II and Mother Teresa and this other might-be saint. I really think it was the might-be saint who really did it. Okay. You know, Rome would never say, you know, they need that case of pure proof that it was that person and that person's family who prayed only to that one potential saint. So it's pretty interesting that it usually comes from the local level.
It's interesting, and this is in so much in the book, but in talking to the people who are involved, let's say, with the miracle in a particular cause, were you surprised that they decided to pick on that particular venerable or servant, or, you know, what was it that attracted the person to that particular future saint?
There's always some kind of connection. So it's either geographic, they're in the same area, like Blessed Miriam Teresa Demjanovic, Michael Mentzer, the little boy who had the healing miracle of blindness, he actually went to this school where Miriam Teresa taught previously. So there was a devotion there already.
See.
So he kind of stepped right into that. And then you have other cases where it's just based on the local connection. But sometimes there's a family reference, or sometimes there are people who prayed when there was a miracle that was similar. In the case of Catherine Drexel, who's not featured in the book, the first case of a healing miracle, Robert Gutherman, he had healing from deafness. And then the next person, Amy Wall, was a child who was deaf, and their family prayed because of the success that Robert Gutherman had with hearing loss coming back in a miraculous way. So I think there are different reasons that people connect to these saints.
But there usually is a connection. That's interesting, as you point out. And you talk about the paths to sainthood and Pope Benedict in 07 and the three principal criteria of sainthood: martyrdom, heroic virtue, and reputation for holiness. And that was updated with a fourth added by Pope Francis, right?
That's right. This is a new path to sainthood, and we're always excited to see more saints. So hopefully that leads to more in the future. But it's called Oblatio Vitae, which is Latin for laying down of one's life or the offering of one's life. And we talk about any of these military chaplains as being prime examples, Emil Capon from Kansas, or the Grunt Padre, Father Vincent Capodanno, as potentials for being considered in this way. So it's not being killed out of hatred of the faith. It's actually giving up your life for another. So,
in fact, that's why you make the point that it sounds similar to a martyr, but it's different. And that was the differentiation that you were pointing out. You also said that there's waiving the need for a second miracle. The Pope may simply confirm, but not introduce a cause.
That's right. And that's called equivalent or equipollent canonization. And that's the term where, through papal prerogative, you have somebody either skipping over the whole process to become a saint, or typically a blessed, like in the case of Junipero Serra, when Pope Francis came to the United States. It's always a very nice thing to canonize a saint from the local nation that he's going to. And so Junipero Serra was lifted up to that next level, even without a second miracle. So that's through papal prerogative in the longstanding tradition of the candidate's sanctity that he's able to move that person ahead and be lifted to the canons of the saints.
Right, and you make the point, candidates for Poliant canonization must meet these criteria. They must be the subject of longstanding cults, such as in the case of St. Margaret of Costello. We just did a documentary on our little Margaret, right, which is a powerful power. I hope people get to see it. It's a wonderful program. You also go back and talk about early Christianity and how a lot of it was just local cults, in a sense of someone in a particular area of a city or a city-state might be have seen to be either a martyr for the faith early on or somebody who demonstrated great faith.
Yeah, absolutely. I think the very first people to be formally canonized were martyrs, but then be canonized for living a life of virtue. That happened later in the church process, and it really rose up from the local levels to see that those two were on par with each other. So that was, there's been a great transition over the years of the process itself. I mean, we always think, you know, when a pope is named, the white smoke coming from the Vatican, that goes back centuries. But maybe that goes back to the 1900s. So some of these traditions have developed over the years, and the exact process of canonization comes to us through Prospero Lambertini, an Italian cardinal who went on to become Pope Benedict XIV. He was born in the 1600s, and that is the rule book they use today for sainthood. So it's only in the recent centuries that this has all been developed the way it is now.
Right. The other thing, I think, you talk about canonizations after 1588, the idea that though someone might be well thought of locally and even called, quote unquote, a saint in their locale, there can't be any public veneration unless the church acknowledges that.
Yeah, and even today when we talk about public veneration, somebody must be a blessed before they actually build a shrine to that potential saint. So even if they've got a venerable, you know, they can't dedicate a shrine or celebrate them in the same way with a feast day as a blessed or a saint. So there's a little bit of that even going on today.
Now, you refer to, and he was known, Pope St. John Paul II was dubbed the great saint maker, but he abolished the devil's advocate. Who was he, and why do you think he did that?
So that's part of the canonization process prior to 1983, in which you have there's a formal position, the promoter of justice, and then there's the defender of the faith. Mm-hmm. And so this devil's advocate, the advocatus diaboli, as he's called, is the person who presents the contrary case to a canonization cause. So we have all the pushing forward of the good news, so to speak, all the virtue, all the positive results of a person's life, their good writings, their good speaking, the good example that they set, but they have to balance it out a little bit, and they have to look at the other side. They open up all the closets, they lift up all the rugs, they make sure that there's no impediment to a canonization. So it's kind of an unfortunate job. I think that, you know, all the excitement comes from when somebody gets declared a saint. There's no glory in kind of tampering down those that excitement and making them not a saint. But Pope John Paul II actually removed that, and now we just have the promoter of justice and who looks at both sides of the case in modern times.
Right. Okay. Very good. Let's talk about the status of each one. We talk about servant of God. What is a servant of God?
So I like to say that the servant of God is when the candidate is out of the gate. So there, that's when the canonization cause is really off to the races. So before that, it's just gathering of documentation, speculation, whether that will be a formal cause. But when it gets approved in Rome as a cause that will be undertaken, they get the label, the stamp, servant of God. What's important to remember is servant of God, although it usually implies that the person lived a holy life, therefore, why would everybody be gathering around this person to promote them? This person isn't a saint when they're a servant of God. Their life of virtue has not been established. It just basically opens the door for that investigation and for the next stage, which is venerable.
Okay.
And
now,
so
could somebody be a servant of God and then be reviewed and decided he doesn't really make the cut? Is he still a servant of God, or does the cause just kind of be put on the side?
You know, I am not aware of any cases where they've been canceled, you know, where they were a servant of God and then they said, well, clearly they did not serve God.
Right.
But there have been cases that have where they have gone away in the sense that the cause does not proceed. It freezes. Gotcha. Nobody picks it up for a long time. And perhaps the person in popular discussion is not referred to as servant of God anymore. But I'm not sure of a formal cancellation process.
Oh, okay. And you were alluding to the next step, right, going into be venerable, right?
So once you're a servant of God and everybody begins to start praying to that person for their devotion, for their intercession, we see the pursuit of the cause gathering all the documentation on the local level. So that's when the diocese sets up an interview process. And if the person died in recent years, like we have somebody like Bishop Alphonse Gallegos or Patrick Payton, there are still people alive who knew that saint, or Father Al Schwartz, for example. There are people who knew that future saint, and so they can actually get a real testimony. Other cases are historical causes where they have to interview historians and people who have studied those lives in great detail. But the diocesan phase does all that investigation, and if everything passes muster, if this positio or academic position paper relating all their virtues, it's a giant book that's sent to Rome. It takes them a few years to read the whole thing, but if they read it and they say, this person looks holy, then they go ahead and they declare that they've lived a life of heroic virtue, and the Pope will issue a very formal promulgation of that decree. Mm-hmm. And so so when that happens, they're called venerable, and then the search for miracles is on.
So so to get to beatification, one has to have a miracle associated?
So with beatification, you need to have a miracle. But when you're venerable, no miracles need be registered.
Right. But oftentimes, to move into the next stage, you would.
Stockpile of old miracles, and I've seen that in a number of causes where miracles happened decades ago. And one example is Francis Xavier Silos. I think the woman she actually was cured of cancer in a remarkable way, where they found no cancer in surgery later. Revealed no scars or anything due to the potential cancer. But then when he was declared venerable, very shortly thereafter, less than a year, he became a blessed because they had this miracle kind of stockpiled in respect.
Right.
But to move from blessed to saint, you need a brand new miracle, sort of to say that Rome is validating or ratifying this decision. So a new miracle has to happen after the announcement of canonization or beatification.
Okay, I understand. Now I understand. Now I'll just say, probably because of the prayers of Mother Angelica and her sisters, they love Blessed Francis Xavier Silos, so I have to put that in there. He was very popular with our sisters. And then finally, canonization.
So canonization is the second miracle. It used to be that you needed something like 3 to 8 miracles in order to go through that whole process, and now you only need 2, thanks to St. John Paul II, the great saint maker who wanted to have more saints be recognized in our churches. Examples for all of us. So a second subsequent miracle is needed, and when that happens, the Pope will also go through that process, and they'll promulgate a decree from the Congregation for the Causes of Saints, and they'll set up the formal ceremony, usually happening in Rome, canonizing a saint. So that's what the 4 Venerables and Blesseds listed in the book. That's what we're all hoping the end point is for any of those people in the book.
Right, and you've got some ones who are obviously very well known, like McGivney. You've got Solanus Casey in here, and I thought the Solanus Casey story where he talks to a person he's walking by, and a person's supposed to have surgery, and he says, well, I'll have the doctors check you before they do surgery, and they check him out, and he doesn't have a tumor anymore.
That's right. There's numerous stories like that. And just this summer, we filmed the new episode of They Might Be Saints on Solanus Casey. It's going to be a great one. And there are so many stories of miracles from his life while he lived and now after his death. You know, people call him the Padre Pio of the United States because the miracles that have been reported are tremendous.
Right, absolutely. And it's interesting, too, I think in the Silos story and that story and in virtually every story, you often find out that these are people in their lives themselves were not always thought of so well, at least by people inside the church. You know, Solanus Casey, he's the porter, he's the guy at the door, you know what I mean? Or Silos gets kicked out of running the seminary because some people are unhappy with the way he goes about doing it, which is, I think, helpful for regular people to understand, right?
That's right. We all struggle in one way or another. We all fall and we try to get back up. And these saints are that great example. I don't think the saints were perfect in any way, and there's no implication from the church that they were, but they are the people that when they were down, they got back up through God's grace. So I think that a lot of these stories can be inspiring to people, and there's probably a different story for every person. I think that everybody can connect to one of these 24 Venerables and Blesseds in a different way and see the way that they struggled and the way that they got back up. So hopefully this will provide inspiration for people.
Absolutely. I wanted to also mention Venerable Augustine Tolton and the story about him and the fact that you did a program on him, right?
Yes, we also filmed that episode this summer that will air next summer. And Father Augustus Tolton, of course, is the first African-American priest. And so his road was remarkable, escaping slavery and with his mother bringing him up to Illinois and then not being able to enter the seminary, even though that was his great dream. Anywhere in the United States, they all rejected him, but he was able to go through the help of some priests here in America. They took him to Rome, and that's where he studied for the priesthood. And then they sent him right back to Quincy, Illinois, where he had grown up. And so he had expected to go to Africa, and he was learning all these African languages and dialects so that he might start anew. But they said, nope, you're going right back home. And no prophet is welcome in his own home, especially in the case of Father Augustus Tolton. But he lifted it up, and people really loved Father Augustus. So his story, especially, I'm a Chicago guy myself, so to see a future Chicago saint is kind of fun for me.
Yeah, Father Gus, as he was called, right? And just before we go, I had to bring up someone who's a project you're just working on, starting now, on Rhoda Wise. Who was Rhoda Wise?
Rhoda Wise, she is a servant of God, so the first of those four steps, and we're excited to present that story because she was a remarkable woman, miracle-wise. She had this home that people would go to and receive miracles. Rhoda herself actually received these great healing miracles, had this tumor, and the resolution of that led her to convert to Catholicism, and Mother Angelica, before she was Mother Angelica, was one of the people who sought out the prayers and visited Rhoda Wise in her home in Canton, Ohio. So we're going to include that in the story as well, because I think that none of us would be here today if Rhoda Wise didn't work that miracle or intercede for that miracle. So it's absolutely amazing, some of the background with these future saints.
That's right. She knew Rita Rizzo when she was Rita Rizzo. So we're looking forward to that. We think that'll be a great story and hopefully raise awareness of Rhoda Wise, who was an important part of Mother Angelica's spiritual upbringing, so to speak. You also have a classic like Fulton Sheen. People might wonder, what's going on with Fulton Sheen these days?
Well, that could be its own show, Doug. I think there's a lot of mystery. Of course, for people who don't know, Fulton Sheen is a venerable. And he's the only venerable in the world who's actually got an approved miracle in his pocket. Usually when a miracle is declared by Rome, very shortly thereafter, the person's beatified. But of course, we saw the postponement of his beatification one December. I guess that was 1 year ago now, but with COVID, I can't remember what year it is anymore.
I think you're right.
But when we talk about his cause going forward, someday soon, I'm sure they will reinitiate that and get a new date set. But as of right now, there's not a lot of information out on when the new beatification date is for Fulton Sheen. But a lot of people here in Illinois are very excited about that as well.
Right. And you also did a program on Aloysius Schwartz, who you mentioned before. So he's always very interesting. And we've had a couple of programs on him. Who of the people that you looked into and weren't so much aware of were you the most impressed by?
Well, I have to say that you know, over the years, I've sort of kept an eye on sainthood causes and followed them as much as I could. But the one that I was really excited about to learn more about was Bishop Frederick Barriga. He's this priest from Slovenia who came to the United States at the request of the Bishop of Cincinnati. And he was sent up to Upper Peninsula, Michigan. And he went on to sort of become known as the snowshoe priest because he would strap on these snowshoes and deliver the sacraments and administer to the sick and the dying. And he would spread the gospel both to the copper miners and to the local Native American communities that were there that invited him to come and baptize them and preach to them. And he spoke 10 different languages or so, and he wrote the dictionary of the Ojibwe language and the Chippewa language, and he just, you know, when we all think about, are we doing enough to catechize, to spread the gospel, to evangelize? We have to look no further than the example of Bishop Frederick Garriga, who put on those snowshoes and traveled thousands of miles in his life to really spread the gospel. So learning more about him has been a true joy, because he's one of my go-to intercessors to help me in my life of faith.
Right, and that was a great program, too, because it really introduced somebody that most of us had never even heard of. Well, thank you, sir, very much, Michael O'Neill, for all your fine work checking out They Might Be Saints on the Path to Sainthood in America, proudly published by us at EWTN Publishing, of course, available through the EWTN Religious Catalog, EWTNRC.com, all things Catholic. Thank you, Mike O'Neill, and thank you all for joining us. We'll see you next time right here on Bookmark.